الحمد لله رب العالمين وصلى الله وسلم على محمد وآله وصحبه وسلم. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. My dear respected brothers and sisters, today we're taking a new lesson, سورة المسد, from this beneficial book by الشيخ العلامة الشيخ Abdul-Aziz ابن Abdullah ابن باز. May Allah have mercy upon him, and may Allah grant us and him جنة الفردوس. آمين. وصلى الله على محمد وآله وصحبه وسلم. سورة المسد. أعوذ بالله السميع العليم من الشيطان الرجيم. تبت يدا أبي لهب وتب, ما أغنى عنه ماله وما كسب, سيصلى نارا ذات لهب, وامرأته حمالة الحطب, في جيدها حبل من مسد. سورة المسد. In the name of Allah, the most beneficent, the most merciful, perish the two hands of Abu Lahab, and perish he, his wealth and his children will not benefit him. He will be burnt in a fire of blazing flames, and his wife too, who carries wood in her neck, is a twisted rope of masad, palm fiber. It is called Surah Al-Masad because it mentions that Ummu Jamil, the wife of Abu Lahab, will have a twisted rope of palm fiber tied around her neck in the hellfire. It is also called Surah Tabbat, a name that is taken from the word, from the first word of the first verse, which means perish the two hands of Abu Lahab. It is also called Abu Lahab and Lahab. The subject matter of this surah deals with the punishment and destruction of Abu Lahab and his wife. Abu Lahab was an enemy of Allah Almighty and his messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So bitter was his enmity that he abandoned his living in order to follow the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam wherever he would go, and discourage people from believing in him. This surah promises him that the hellfire will surround him from all directions, and that he will roast therein. His wife accompanies him because she was his partner, helping him to harm the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Its relation to what is before it. In Surah An-Nasr, Allah Almighty informs us that the recompense for the obedient worshipper is victory in this world and a great reward in the hereafter. Meanwhile, in Surah Al-Masad, Allah Almighty shows us the end awaiting the disobedient, loss in this world and punishment in the hereafter. In what context was this surah revealed? In their Sahih, Al-Bukhari and Muslim recorded that Sa'id ibn Jubair narrated that Ibn Abbas said, when وَأَنْدِرْ عَشِيرَتَكَ الْأَقْرَبِينَ, and warn your tribe of near kindred, was revealed, Allah's Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam climbed As-Safa and said, Ya Sabaha, a loud call for help, one that is usually made during the morning time. The people of Quraysh gathered around him and said, "What is the matter with you?" He said, "أرأيتم إن أخبرتكم أن العدو مصبحكم أو ممسيكم أما كنتم تصدقوني؟" If I were to tell you that the enemy was coming in the morning or evening, would you believe me? They said, "Yes, indeed." He sallallahu alayhi wasallam said, "فإني نذير لكم بين يدي عذاب شديد." Then I am a warner to you of an imminent punishment that is severe. Abu Lahab said, "Perish and loss to you. Is this why you called us?" And when Allah Almighty revealed, then Allah Almighty revealed, "Tabbat yada Abi Lahab." So this is the reason why this ayah and these verses were revealed. "Perish the two hands of Abu Lahab and perish he." The meaning of the word, "Tabbat yada Abi Lahabin," "Tabbat yada Abi Lahabin," literally, "May his hand be perished and lost." But here it is referring to his deeds. "Watab," the word for perished is used again. But this time it means, "May he be perish himself in the hellfire." "ما أغنى عنه ماله وما كسب." "ما أغنى عنه ماله وما كسب." What will his wealth serve him in the face of Allah's anger and punishment in this world and in the hereafter? "وما كسب," i.e. his wealth, children, and so on. "سيصلى نارا ذات لهب." He will be burnt in a fire of blazing flames. ذات لهب, blazing and burning. "ومرأته," means أم جميل, his wife, حمالة الحطب, i.e. she will carry the thorns of سعدان, which is a very thorny plant, which she used to scatter on path. She expected the Prophet ﷺ to take في جيدها, i.e. on her neck, حبل من مسد, i.e. made from palm fiber. The meaning, in summary, the surah discusses the destruction of Abu Lahab, an uncle of the Prophet ﷺ. He was a bitter enemy and would inflict severe harm on the Prophet ﷺ. He had no religion, no scruples, and not even a sense of loyalty to relatives. May Allah punish him severely. Allah Almighty condemned Abu Lahab in this surah, which is to serve as a humiliation for him until the day of judgment. So he said, "Tabbat yada Abi Lahabin," "Watab," perish the hands of Abu Lahab, meaning he would be lost and humiliated in his work, in his works. "Watab," and he will never escape and perish he. "ما أغنى عنه ماله," his wealth and children will not benefit him. The wealth he has that causes him to transgress. "وما كسب," none of this will avert Allah's punishment from him when he suffers it. "سيصلى نارا ذات لهب," he will be burnt in a fire of blazing flames, meaning he will be surrounded by the fire from every side. He and his wife who carried the wood, she was severe in her atrocities against Allah's Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam. She and her husband cooperating in sin and transgression, rushing and hastening to evil in any way they could to harm the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. She would even scatter a sa'dan, a tree that has thorns, thorns in the path where the Prophet ﷺ would walk. في جيدها حبل من مسد, in her neck is a twisted rope of مسد. meaning around their neck will be a rope of fiber as a judgment from Allah for the enemy against Allah and His Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam. What can be derived from these verses? Allah Almighty destroyed not only Abu Lahab's wicked plans to hurt the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, but destroyed him as well. Number two, neither money nor children can avail a person when he deserves the hellfire for perpetrating deeds that anger Allah Almighty. Three, it is categorically forbidden to harm a believer. Four, that being related to a righteous person will be of no help if one is following shirk and disbelief. For was not Abu Lahab the uncle of the Prophet ﷺ, and is not his abode the blazing hellfire? See, here we learn, barakallahu feekum, my dear respected brothers and sisters, that the lineage does not matter when it comes to the standards of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In this world, people, they respect people with good lineage. They raise them, you know, the people with the social status and the like. They have a lot of reverence, a lot of respect for them. Even though these people could be corrupt because they come from a good lineage and the like. But when it comes to the hereafter, the scale is completely different. The balance is completely different. The standards are completely different. Abu Lahab, even though he was the uncle of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he will enter the hellfire, as Allah mentioned here in this ayah. So it doesn't matter if he is related to the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. That would not help him. That would not help him. And this is also a refutation against those that brag and boast, and they say we are from the lineage of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, from his family tree and the like. And this is if it's true. This is if it's true. Even if we say, for the sake of the argument, that you are related to the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam in terms of the lineage, that would not help you unless you follow the way of Allah and his Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and you follow the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam as Allah commanded us to follow him. As Allah said in the Quran, وَمَا أَتَاكُمُ الرَّسُولُ فَخُدُوهُ وَمَا نَهَاكُمْ عَنُهُ فَانْتَهُوا. Whatever the Messenger of Allah brings you from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you comply with that. And whatever he commands you to stay away from, you stay away from. So how is the lineage going to help someone who does not act upon the commandment of Allah, does not stay away from the prohibition? The lineage is not going to do this person any good. طيب. The fifth, there is an amazing miracle in this chapter. It was revealed why Abu Lahab and his wife were still alive. And it informed them that they would be punished in the hellfire, which meant that they would not accept Islam before they died. Because if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned that they would enter the hellfire, this necessitates that they will not accept Islam. Because Allah knows, Allah knew it, subhanahu wa ta'ala. As it is in the hadith, the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he wrote everything that will take place in terms of his qadr, his predestination. He wrote everything that will take place 50,000 years before he created the heavens and earth. Everything that would take place. And the first thing Allah created was the pen. In terms of the creation of the heavens and earth and that. But before that, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created his throne. So the throne is the first thing that Allah created. But in terms of the heavens and earth and the like, then the pen. The pen is the first thing that Allah created. Shaykh al-Uthaymeen mentioned this, rahimahullah ta'ala. So Allah created the pen and he commanded the pen to write everything that will take place until the day of judgment. And from it is this incident here. that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he mentioned Abu Lahab and his wife, that he mentioned that they will be in the hellfire while they were still alive. It shows you that they will die upon kufr and they will enter the hellfire. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is just in his legislation, subhanahu wa ta'ala. He's the all just in his legislation, in his decree. Subhanahu wa ta'ala, he does not wrong anyone. No one gets oppressed, no one gets wronged. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he sent the messengers to clarify. As Allah said in the Quran, وَمَا كُنَّا مُعَدِّبِينَ حَتَّى نَبْعَثَ رَسُولًا. And we will not punish anyone from the creation until we send the messenger. So the messenger, his job is to clarify the message. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَمَا يُشَاقِغَ الرَّسُولِ مِنْ بَعْدِ مَا تَبَيِّنَ لَهُ الْهُدَى وَيَتَّبِعَ غَيْرِ سَبِيلِ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ وَلِّهِ مَا تَوَلَّى وَنَصْلِهِ جَهَنَّمُ وَسَاءَتْ مَصِيرًا. Whoever contends with the messenger, whoever opposes the messenger. The messenger here is Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. After guidance has been clarified to him. After guidance has been clarified to him. So there is no excuse. Because the messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he clarified everything. And he said sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, taraktukum ala al-bayda. Layluha ka nahariha. La yazighu anha ba'di illa halik. He said, I have left you upon the clear path. I have left you what? Upon what? The clear path. Laylaha ka nahariha. Its night is like its day. As clear as the sun in the middle of the day. La yazighu anha ba'di illa halik. None will deviate from it after me, except that he will be destroyed. And that's why al-ulama, like al-imam Malik rahimahullah, he mentioned, as it is in Majmu' al-Fatawa by Shaykh Islam, Imam Malik ibn Anas, he said, the Sunnah is like the Ark of Noah. It's like the Ark of Noah. Whoever embarks upon it will reach safety and salvation. And whoever refuses, he will drown. So, the Messenger of Allah, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he clarified everything. So there is no excuse for anyone on Yawm al-Qiyamah. So, Abu Lahab, he refused the haqq, the truth that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent with his messenger Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Rather, he fought the messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam severely. And he had so much enmity, severe enmity towards the messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. This is also a lesson for us, a great lesson for us, for those who are in the da'wah field, those who are calling the people to Islam. The road is not paved with the roses, barakallahu feekum. You're going to encounter many challenges from the people. The people, they're going to malign you. They're going to revile you. They're going to speak ill about you. They're going to try to tarnish your reputation. But you have to be firm. You have to be patient. Because not all the people are going to accept your da'wah, even though your da'wah is da'wah al-haqq, is the call of the truth. But the people, some of them have desires in their heart, so they don't accept the haqq. They don't accept it. So they will oppose it and they will fight it and they will fight you. So you have to be patient. You have to be patient. Stand your ground. Don't get weak. Stand your ground. You're going to be harassed. You're going to be verbally abused. And you may even get hurt physically. So you have to be patient. You have to be patient. And remember the hadith of Prophet ﷺ. He said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the people that goes through the hardest trials, number one, are the prophets and messengers, peace be upon them. Because there's no one who gets tested more than them. Some of them, they were even killed. Yes, they were killed in the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So they were persecuted. And their followers also, they get persecuted. Look at Bilal radiallahu anhu. They used to persecute him in the middle of the heat of the desert. They put a rock, a big rock on his body. But he would not give up La ilaha illallah. He would not give up his deen. He would not succumb to them. The Salafiyun, they're supposed to be strong, like a mountain. They don't get shaken up by trials and tribulations. You're going to go through that when you give da'wah to the people. Not everyone's going to accept. Some of them, they're going to reject the da'wah. They're going to reject your call. And not only reject, but they're going to oppose you. And they're going to start spreading, you know, false rumors about you and the like. So you have to stand your ground. You have to be patient. And ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to aid you. And have ikhlas. Because ikhlas, if you have ikhlas, you will see fruits. If you have sincerity and you're sincere in your da'wah, you will see fruits, inshallah ta'ala. The Shaykh went on to say, there is an amazing miracle in this chapter. It was revealed while Abu Lahab and his wife were still alive, and it informed them that they would be punished in the hellfire, which meant that they would not accept Islam before they died. And indeed, things turned out exactly as Allah Almighty informed. And He Almighty is the all-knower of both the seen and the unseen. Subhanahu wa ta'ala. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to grant us all beneficial knowledge and righteous action. Walhamdulillah rabbil alameen. Wa sallallahu wa sallam ala Muhammadin wa alihi wa sahbihi wa sallim.